Radio, where gamers roll.
www.unedited.com. You burst through the door, you find a small room filled with gold and jewels, and a red dragon. He starts to breathe. Save or die!
Welcome to the Save or Die Podcast, a podcast about classic Dungeons & Dragons. If it's in a box, we'll talk about it.
Hello, folks, and welcome to episode number 17, the lost episode. This originally was number 16 before Audacity ate the show. The whole crew was involved, Mike, Liz, Glenn, and myself. We pretty much did the same things we did in adventure number 16, just expanded a little bit more upon it. So sit back, enjoy, and listen to the unedited raw version of number 16, now entitled 17, and listen and stay tuned for more holiday episodes as Save or Die is on vacation. Happy holidays and Happy New Year, everybody. Bye. Adventure number 16, I believe, after we argued this in the beginning. DM Vince here, along with DM Mike.
Yo.
DM Liz.
Hello.
And the illustrious DM Glenn. Okay. And we're back for another fun and exciting week after we just had a wonderful interview with Mike Carr. We all enjoyed that.
Didn't you guys? Was cool.
Yeah.
That was fun.
Yeah, and we heard a lot of good secrets from the back and everything like that. So
yeah. I was amazed that, you know, not only did he remember so much from the time, but he was willing to share all of it with us.
Yeah.
True. Yeah. He was willing.
I didn't know Brian Bloom used to wear a tutu around the office.
Shh, you're not supposed to tell anyone that.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, but the high heels were really
my gosh.
Yeah.
So, let's kick Glenn down the stairs and let's go into the cauldron room. And what have we been doing classical lately? Starting with, we'll go with me. Nothing. Except for reading the module that was due for this adventure that we picked. I really haven't been doing anything. Actually, I've been playing an online game, so.
There you go.
But, Glenn, what about you?
Well, other than reading the module for this week, that and negotiating with Mike and Liz for the Rule Cyclopedia, that's about it.
Really?
Yeah, my life is simple.
You're just a simple little man, huh?
Simple, yes. Little, well.
All right, Mike, what have you been up to?
Grading tests, so I really haven't had any time to do anything this week either. Again, other than reading the module.
Right.
Hopefully there'll be more time coming up in January.
Yeah. Hopefully. And what about you, Liz?
Not much either. I have managed to do some flipping around through the Holmes rule book in addition to going over the module for today, but most of my time has been up with getting ready to graduate, taking my finals this past week, blah, blah, blah. But that's all over and done with now. And like Mike said, after the holidays are over, theoretically, there should be way more time to do stuff.
So more time to dedicate to Save or Die.
Yes.
Okay, perfect.
Save or Die will become the focus of my life in 2011.
You heard it, folks.
A feeling we all share.
Yes, you heard it, folks.
And it should be the focus of all of your lives as well.
Were it not for reality.
Although, somebody on Dragon's Foot did point out something to me when in the side adventure we last did, when there was the talk about Lamentations of the Flame Princess. Apparently, at least their core rules are available free as a download off their website.
Yes, I have a copy.
So
I don't know. Couldn't they have named it something a little bit better than what they named it?
What, the Vince game?
The Vince game, what?
Lamentations of the Flame Princess. That sounds like a mini-series or something.
I don't don't know. It kind of reminds me of a Conan-ish sort of novel,
yeah,
which may have been the feeling they were going for.
Yeah. Maybe. As the sands of time turn deeply into the hourglass of our lives. Oh, that's
those are the days of our lives.
Yes, wrong show.
those are the lamentations of the Flame Princess.
Bum, bum, bum.
I'm McDonald Carey. Welcome to the... No.
But no, I've heard it's kind of a modified mold bay.
Really?
So I haven't had a chance to look at it yet. Though apparently their campaign world is... I had assumed it was a lot of weird fantasy because I had heard it basically advertised as that. And, of course, it was had Carcosa as part of it, or will. But I've been told, anyway, that the campaign is actually fairly historical. So I kind of look forward to having the free time to look that over.
The title kind of put me off because Lamentations of the Flame Princess immediately made me think of, like, Empire of the Petal Throne. Which is not exactly my favorite.
What's wrong with EPT?
I just don't like it. It's weird.
Yes. Yes, it is.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. I got one agreement out of my good.
That's all you're going to get.
Yeah.
All right, so let's head over to Game On. I think that wraps up this section, really. So, in Game On this week, we have... The infamous Critical Hits and Fumbles.
Right. This is all Glenn's fault.
This is all Glenn's fault.
Well, yep. You know, I
gotta suggested
it. I got to come up with a winner once in a while, you know.
Hey, I'm just glad somebody's coming up with stuff, you know.
Hey, I come up with stuff on a daily basis, pal.
You just never tell me about it.
That's correct.
I'm going to start naming you DM Marvin.
Marvin?
Yeah, Mike. Brain the size of a planet, I gotta do everything around
here. So, what can we say about Critical... Do we use them? I know I use them. Mike, do you use them?
Sort of.
Sort of.
How sort of?
Well, I used to do the standard, you know, a 20 double damage kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
But I got into a debate on Dragon's Foot with one of the guys in the first edition forum named Stormcrow.
Where else would you have a debate?
Well, have a debate, classic D&D section.
No, I just meant where else would there be a debate other than Dragon's Foot?
Other than Dragon's Foot. Okay, yeah, good point. And anyway, he brought up some examples and pointed out that all these, you know, they tend to kind of when you have double, triple, whatever damage, you're kind of going against the grain of the whole hit point combat system. And after thinking about it, I came to where I agreed with him. On the other hand, there always needs to be, you know, it's so part of the game now. You roll a 20, that's something cool, right? Yeah. You roll a 1, that's something bad.
Right.
So what I do is for a 20... You just do max damage. You don't have to roll any damage dice or anything. It's just whatever your maximum damage would be, that's it.
Mike, that comes from the edition that shall not be named.
Well, I didn't do that. I came up with that totally on my own years ago, so.
Ha. So actually, they stole it from Mike.
They stole it from me.
Oh,
yeah. There you go.
Yeah, okay.
And I would be a millionaire 10 times over if they had...
Right, and so that's what you do. Okay, so what do you? What was the whole debate? Was that it shouldn't be done? Is what he was saying?
Well, if you consider how hit points and hit die are set up in the game and the damage for various weapons,
Right,
the whole paradigm is thrown out the window if a dagger can suddenly potentially do 8 to 12 hit points of damage. Depending on whether you do double damage, triple damage, da-da-da.
Bah. I don't agree.
You can look up the debate if you want on Dragon's Foot, but, you know, we went round and round for it for a while, and I thought, you know, yeah, he's got a point.
I still think, you know, a weapon could hit a vital area and do more.
That's
just like, you know, okay, I took the dagger and I
hit but the counter-argument is that's what the range of damage is for. That vital area, say, for a dagger, would be the 4 points.
Well, then would you like map out the body and saying, okay, he hit him in the jugular so he does this many points?
No,
you roll a die.
No, but then the counter argument becomes, if you're going to start considering potentially critical areas, what's really the points, dare I say, of excessive hit points?
Are you saying this, if you hit for, say, 12 points on a 12-sided die, you actually hit a vital area?
Yeah. To do more damage than you would normally do. Because if you want to set it up to where literally a blow can kill somebody regardless of their hit points, then you're kind of... Then what's the whole point of the hit point system?
Luck. And thinking about it, I mean, say you're playing an assassin. Well, assassins are trained to do the
maximum
damage.
Well, assassins, that's a different system, and it's a different game. Brown Book has assassins.
Right. I knew it was somewhere in Basic. But yeah, because I was saying, like, they're trained to do that every time.
There's a special mechanic for assassins
close.
To do an assassination.
Right.
It's different from the normal combat system.
So, okay, that's another question. So if you like have a critical hit system like that, does that take away from the assassin's special ability?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a valid argument, because if you're going to have assassins...
Because if anybody can crit, you know...
Which, by the way, I prefer the Brown Book assassins who can be neutral rather than the first edition and second edition versions that had to be evil.
Yeah.
Well, okay. First editions. I don't know about second edition.
I don't think there was an assassin in second edition.
They got rid of so many other quests.
It wasn't initially, but then when they did like... Yeah, when they did like complete books of naval lint and stuff, I think... I don't know what he was like, or something, but...
He came back in third. He took a little vacation in second edition. Mainly that was just, okay, I'm a thief. I'm an assassin. Okay, fine, you're an assassin. You just call him an assassin.
I like to use critical hits. I don't care about the argument. You know, if someone rolls a 20, it should be celebrated, and then let them have double damage, and then I usually do the great Joe DM method of rolling the d20 again.
And what is that?
When you, I was explaining it before you rudely interrupted me, and
I will go pay penance to Joe.
Okay.
Okay, I'm back.
Okay, good. You roll a d20 and you roll it again. If you get a certain target number that I've decided, which I won't reveal here, but no, it's anywhere between 19 and 20 again, you get triple damage, 2.5 damage. And you roll again. If you get a 20 again, it becomes 3 times damage.
Okay, so that's where you and I part ways.
Do the monsters get it too?
Oh, yeah, monsters get it too. Yeah. It's only fair if both sides get it.
To me, I like crits, okay? I'll say that right up front. I like using critical hits, but to me, it only goes like one step. Hey, you rolled a 20. You do double damage. That's it. You keep rolling the 20, and, you know, then it starts getting ridiculous if you keep making, like, a 19 or a 20. And believe me, I've seen it happen. Doesn't happen very often, but I've seen it happen. And you and I, Vince, were debating about this. The method of backing crits just doesn't seem right.
That's stupid. I hate that method. It's a third edition method that's stupid.
It was before that. I mean, I've seen DMs played in first edition.
Really?
And go, okay. What? You mean
backing
I
crits?
The yeah.
Confirming.
Say you roll,
confirming.
A natural 20. Okay. You crit. Now back it. You got to roll like what? A 19 or a 20?
No.
To make sure you hit.
You have to roll the 2 hit number or above again to confirm that it's a critical hit.
Yeah. I mean, you got a crit. Why do you need to confirm it?
Yeah, I don't agree with that either.
Yeah, that was a dumb third edition rule that I hated, and you guys said it was before then. I've never seen anyone play with it before third edition. So,
ooh,
yeah,
does remind me of another part of the argument that Stormcore and I were going around about. What do you do if you need a 20 to hit the creature.
You roll a 20?
So when you hit, you also do double damage?
Yeah.
Even though that's all you needed to hit?
Yeah.
If that was the only thing you could possibly roll to hit, you not only hit, you do double damage as well?
Yeah, according to what the house rules are, 20, a natural 20 is a double damage.
I disagree with that, but, you know, that's a house rule thing.
Right, it's a house rule. It's never said that 20 is an actual critical hit. It's just an automatic hit, but...
Yeah. Actually, I think it's only an automatic hit in 2nd edition. Any of the basics have that?
First has that, I know that. I remember reading it in there. It says a 20 is an automatic hit, just like a 1 is an automatic failure.
I don't recall that, but I'm rusty on my 1E. I've been doing so much basic and expert stuff.
I could be wrong, though. I'm not the buy-the-book person.
It's funny, we argue about crits, but nobody seems to have any problem about fumbles.
I do fumbles the opposite way, too, so...
Oh, do you?
Fumble? Yeah, you can back fumble. Like, you roll 1, and then you can roll again. If you roll a very low number again, it becomes even worse.
And then gonna do that, though?
That was the other part of... And I'm glad Crispy isn't here, because he'd crucify me after that Mazes and Monsters thing, but... Liz and I used to do medieval reenactment.
Oh.
And we did live steel, or I did anyway. I was involved in the live steel combat with plate and chain armors with blunted swords.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And I was in a lot of fights. I saw a lot of fights. You just don't drop a weapon or hit people on a 5% of the time. In combat, it just doesn't happen that often.
Huh.
That's why generally I used to do, you know, the drop the weapon, hit a friend, da 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 da. Certainly entertaining, but, you know, plausibly I just, you know, the more I got it, the more it's like it just doesn't happen that often.
See, and that's where I come from with the critical hits and misses. I'm not that concerned about the plausibility of it. I think it's very fun and entertaining in a game session, so I don't mind using them. And I certainly don't mind having things get better or worse, you know, having them explode either for the good or for the bad. I think, you know, one of my favorite memories is still that game where we had with Robert... And he fumbled twice in a row.
That magic sword exploded.
Yes! That was hilarious. I mean, we all got hurt, but, you know, we
and
were laughing around.
For the rest of the episode, for the rest of the adventure.
I know, but we were all laughing around the table, and it was just the best time, you know. It was absolutely horrid, but we had a
That's
lot
another
of
take
fun
on tragedy bringing people together.
I know.
Remember with Connie and Alan in the cave? The blade slinger?
Oh, yeah.
Like 3 or 4 of y'all all dropped your weapons in the same fight? Oh.
See? Yeah, it's not realistic, but some of the best gaming moments happen when you either make a really, really great hit, critical hit, or a truly terrifying fumble or series of fumbles.
Hey, Vince?
And
yes?
I think they should stay.
Hey, Vince.
Yes?
The sword, 25 feet up in the ceiling.
Oh, boy.
Have to throw a dwarf to catch it.
Yeah, that was the actual...
use any excuse to toss a dwarf.
Yeah, his axe...
He asked for it!
He wanted to be thrown.
It was crispy, too.
Yeah. That was in the actual play podcast. The dwarf got his axe stuck in the ceiling and he wanted it back so badly. Instead of listening to the thief when he said, why don't we take a bolt and tie a rope to it and shoot it up there and try to lasso it around it or something, or a hook. Why don't we just take the dwarf and toss him up there?
And since my fighter was the strongest.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yep. Why don't we do that?
Okay, yes, I will agree, from a purely entertainment value, it does have its moments, definitely.
Yeah, it does.
Well, back to crits and fumbles.
That was part of Christian Fumbles. What are you talking about?
Well, I know. Okay, fine.
I'm sorry. We weren't focusing on you, Glenn.
This is what happens when I try to impersonate Vince.
I'm sorry, Glenn. Let's focus on you. Go ahead.
Crits is good.
So we all know what we do for criticals, but what about fumbles? You heard what I did. What about you guys? You guys play with the fumbles, or we'll start with Liz. Liz, go first.
Go, Liz.
Yes, definitely the fumbles, and I don't really have a hard and fast rule of how I do them. Basically, if you get the one, then it's definitely a fumble, and rather than do a D20 again, usually I just do percentiles to see how bad the fumble is or is not, and just have kind of a range, you know, and come up with something on the fly depending on how well or how badly it rolled on the percentiles on the fumble.
Hmm. Okay. Do you like make up outcomes as you see fit, or just you kind of use the old broke the sword, drop the sword thing? Or?
A little of each, because the drop the weapon thing, you know, that's good across the board no matter what situation you're in. Mm-hmm. But if you're in a specific situation and I can come up with something that would work in that particular moment that wouldn't necessarily otherwise, you know, I might throw that in.
So you use the percentile kind of as a catastrophe gauge.
Right, and then cool. Decide from there, okay, something happens, but how bad is it? And it could be, you know, anything within that range of badness. You drop your sword, you stub your toe, your bowstring breaks, accidentally decapitate your party member on your left.
Whoa.
Well, actually, nothing that bad has ever happened.
Oh, well, that's harsh.
If it was Vince's game, it would.
Be quiet. It's because I'm an evil DM.
Wahaha.
Evil.
Yeah, everybody can be evil. Mike, what do you do?
Like I said, the likelihood of dropping, et cetera, bugs me. So basically what I do...
Okay, really?
And that is the penalty that the character takes on their next initiative.
Hmm.
So that's the it's a penalty, but it's not catastrophic.
Okay. Cool. Glenn?
Well, roll a one. I describe something colorful, usually in the form of you drop your weapon or something like that, and that's pretty much it. Now, in the days when we used to also play Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay...
Oh God.
Grab the charts out of there, because you could do something like, well, you swing your sword and miss the guy, but it flies out of your head, and this other orc over here catches it in his chest.
Yikes.
Oh, you're leaving out some of the lovely details.
Oh, the blood comes spurting out of his chest in a pool. He goes down
pouring.
And pouring out. Yes.
Like,
I think we just played that game just for those tables.
Wow.
Our friend Kevin imported the tables into his D&D game. And
yes.
Yeah, that's some horrible, horrible things.
Yes, it was our blood and gore period. But usually, like I said, if I don't have the tables, it's just like, you're what? Okay, you dropped your weapon, or you smacked this guy in the face next to you, or something like that.
Okay.
So kind of a Liz system, actually.
Yeah. I just don't go in for how bad. And it's like, oh, your weapon goes flying, then I roll like an 8-sided die. It went in that direction over there. You know, that's about it.
I figure if you're going to have the critical hits be possibly catastrophically good, then you should also have the possibility of a catastrophically bad miss.
That's true.
Yeah,
epic
that's true.
Fail.
That's right. Epic fail.
Yes. Epic hit, epic fail. Goes along with epic fail.
All right.
How about you, Vince?
I already said it.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
The DM Joe.
How about the DM Joe? Yes.
Yeah, pretty much. I do criticals the same way I do the I do fumbles the same way I do criticals, and use the one system and roll again if he kind of. I haven't done it in my actual play podcast because I don't want to kill them that badly, but.
Yeah, but it's crispy.
Not yet, anyway.
No. Yeah, I know. You guys got beat up the last time pretty bad, though.
Well, it was pumpkin men.
Pumpkin satyrs.
Pumpkin satyrmen.
That's right. That explodes.
The great pumpkin himself.
That explodes.
Yeah.
I came up with that an hour before our show. I was bored.
Though, while we're on the subject, do you use critical successes and failures with other roles than combat?
Yes. You mean and, like skill things or like
yeah, like thief skills, damage?
Yes. Oh, damage? No, I don't do damage.
Like I do damage with crossbows.
Like exploding yeah. damage?
Yes.
So if they roll, because like, say, a 4 out of 4, they can roll again?
They roll again, yeah.
If they get a 4, they can roll again?
No, I basically it explodes once, but to me it's something that makes the crossbow different than just a bow.
Exploding arrows, I like that.
No, the damage explodes.
Yeah, just exploding damage is all.
Oh, I thought they were evil arrows.
No, they're quasi evil
arrows.
They're like the Diet Coke of evil.
Okay. And remember, the reverse of evil is live, and we all want to do that, don't we?
Wow.
But Uncle Mikey says that...
Uncle Mikey!
Uncle Mikey says, be good.
Yes.
And if you can know the quote where Mikey. Movie those quotes came from, you get a cookie.
Rock and rule.
Yep.
I used to have a VHS tape of that. Yep.
Okay, so let's head out of Game On. And into Random Encounters for the night. So, Random Encounters.
Yes, something when we start talking about animated movies, it's time to move on.
Yeah.
Yes.
Kind of following up kind of on the monster we had last week of a bugbear that was sort of like a goblin Bigfoot type thingy. We have goblin hordes this week.
Oh, I thought it was Hordes.
Okay. Yeah, they're Hispanic. That's why. Glenn.
Wait a minute. I think I remember seeing the Hordes. They were on a Doctor Who episode.
I was going to try to get through one episode without a Doctor Who reference. Mike?
Nope, you can't.
Even torture me on RFI with that, too. Doctor Who.
No. Nick started it on RFI. I just agreed.
True.
we got goblins with sombreros and stuff? Or?
No, it's hordes, Glenn. Hordes. Not whores. Hordes.
We don't need those stinking badges. Okay.
So, Mike, you picked goblin hordes. Why did you pick goblin hordes as opposed to just goblins?
Well, part of the reason was because of the module we're going to be reviewing.
Okay.
And generally, goblins are one of those monsters, at least in published adventures and stuff, that usually are, unless it's just a first level only adventure, you rarely run into one or two goblins. It's usually 4 or 5 or a dozen or 30. Whatnot.
How about 30?
Or 30, yeah. 30, 50. I mean, you look in the rules under the monster sections for number encountered, you can run into quite a pile of them.
Yeah.
And I've seen DMs run them where, you know, that's a horde of goblins. They all charge you in a line with their swords.
And a conga line of goblins.
The next one. Okay, you kill it. The next one. It's a conga line of death. And
splat.
Kind of like those old 70s martial arts films where
they all just kind of rotate around, hopping. Yeah.
Yeah.
Trying to attack the hero one at a time. Yeah.
Yeah.
Very nice of them, isn't it?
I like doing goblin tactics. I like taking those monsters everybody think are just cookie cutter monsters and making them do like really cool, clever things.
Well, especially in what's supposed to be their lair.
Yeah.
Or the dungeon or whatnot. I mean, that's where they live. You know they would have set up something.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, why can't the little gobbies, like a couple of them, go up and attack like the cookie cutters, and the rest of them like try to sneak around and backstab you? Or maybe they like have like a trap, like Mike said, of like a rock or on a rope, and or a stick on a rope, and they push it down to try to hit the players or something. You know,
push them near a covered pit and push them in. Yeah,
or get under the knees.
A pit that's covered just enough to where a small creature like a goblin can run across, but a human in plate, for example. Squish goes right through.
That's right.
Yeah, or you can have one goblin lead the whole group back to a whole ambush of a bunch of goblins that are hiding in the trees, throwing things at you.
Mm-hmm. Or even just creating, you know, especially in dungeons, because you got so many narrow passages, you can set up a small shield wall with spears, and it's difficult to get past.
Wow. They're using kobold tactics. Oh, my God.
Yeah, kobolds.
Oh, you got a kobold reference, too.
Woohoo!
Yeah.
Kobolds are
well, at least
they're cute.
Yeah, well, they keep that keep within the D&D framework there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I'll keep this one for later. Goblins can be pretty nasty in numbers like that.
But all too often, it's just you open a door, there's 20 goblins. They all leap up and run at you at once, and it just seems like that.
As the back half push the first half in front, and they run.
Well, yeah, it's like there's 20 goblins in the room. You open the door, you see 20 goblins. Well, how do you know exactly it's 20 goblins? First of all, you sit there going 1, 2. You don't have enough time to do that.
Well, they're all standing in a line waiting to get hit. I might as well.
they all took a number, you see. And
I was going to say, they have numbered tabards on.
That's right.
You open the door and go, sound up!
Yeah, so you open the door, there's 20 goblins in the room. You'd say the first 5 jump up that are in front of you to attack. You see one running over to the alarm bell, one running out the back door, one doing this. You know, there's so many things they could do, except all just line up, like Mike said, going, dun-dun-dun-dun, kill me.
Exactly. And just seems like that's not often used.
Yeah.
Especially the, you know, 20 goblins, 10 maybe fight just to hold the party at bay while the other 10 go to either set up maybe 5 to set up an ambush, the other 5 to go inform the rest of the plays.
And a couple of them to throw like rocks and stuff at the mage in the back who's casting.
Yeah, spears.
Yeah.
I think it all has to do with a DM just not having enough time sometimes to do things.
Yeah, that can be a problem, I guess. Yeah. But, I mean, some of this tactics can just be done on the fly.
Well, yeah, like when you guys are fighting the pumpkin-headed satyrs, for example, in my campaign, and you guys were in a narrow area, so not all 8 of them were able to get in there, so that's why they were in sort of the conga line thing you were talking about, because only 4 at a time could get up to you guys. Mm. So, yeah. There, I told you.
The guy in the back. Boy, when I get up there, I'm going to give him such a...
Yeah.
I'm going to take him out, man.
Yeah, can we
get to random or to products of your imagination, we can talk about this again as to how the goblins are used in that module.
Yeah.
Without giving any spoilers.
Yep.
Well, we could head in there now if you have anything else to say.
No,
I think we're cool.
I think we're all right. Yeah.
All right, we'll head into Products of Your Imagination. So Products of Your Imagination this week is going to be a B5, Horror on the Hill by Douglas Niles, which we have an interview scheduled with him for next episode. Well, it wouldn't be next episode, it would be next release. So we do have a question and answer forum up, so you can put some questions up, because I know you people want to know lots of information from Mr. Doug Niles.
Yeah, come on, people. Put some questions up there.
Yeah, exactly.
Crack the whip.
So, let's do first impressions. My first impression on this module was I liked it. It was cool. It was kind of... It flowed really well, and I only had one problem with it, and I talked about it with Glenn. But we'll talk about it when we get more into the module. I actually like the adventure in overall. Mike?
I'm torn.
Torn.
I've heard it referred to once as B2 on steroids.
Yeah, true.
And I can see where that would come about. It's a big place. I mean, it's, what, 100 encounter locations?
Yeah, something like that.
That's a big hill.
Goes on and on and on.
Yeah, but
in a way...
Go ahead. No, I was going to say, yeah, but they don't fill all 100 rooms.
Well, yeah, let Mike
close.
Yeah, Mike, continue with your impression.
Go ahead.
I don't know. It feels kind of like a mega dungeon in a way.
Yeah.
Because there's an awful lot here, and I find it this is not an adventure that a party is going to clear in one expedition. I find it very hard to believe. They're going to have to make this several expeditions if they're truly going to clear the whole place out. And part of it you may not even find.
True.
Okay. Unless you're really, you know.
Yeah, that's very true.
So that's my...
You're torn.
I'm half and half on it.
You're torn. Okay.
Yeah.
Liz?
She's torn, too.
I guess she is torn.
I hear her talking, but...
Liz must be on muted mic.
From her room,
yes,
but...
sorry.
There we go.
Sorry. I really do like this module. It's got a lot of things in it that I enjoy seeing in modules, like the rumor table and other stuff like that. Like Mike said, I can certainly see where people would make comparisons with B2, if for no other reason than you have the place where you're starting out from, with the inn, with the general store, with the stuff that you can use to, you know,
it's
arm yourselves up.
Yeah, Guido's fort instead of just the keep.
Yeah. Guido's. But I think it's different enough that I would not necessarily call it a cookie cutter of B2. And I also like that this is an adventure for first through third level, but there are things that you can run into that are way too powerful for you to try to go head to head with. You should be running in some of these encounters rather than trying to stay and fight. And I think that's very true to the spirit of basic D&D and, you know, a lot of the early stuff.
Right.
Okay. And Glenn?
Well, it's a romp. I like it. It's a lot of fun. There's a couple things that I go, why did they do it that way? But other than that, on the whole, I'd have a good time in this dungeon. I've heard it also being called a meat grinder. But, yeah, it's going to be a meat grinder if you're stupid, if your character's stupid. But I don't see anything that, like, reasonable precautions wouldn't take care of. One thing that kind of bugs me is to get down to the second level, you have to do something that is, like... All right, you got to fall in a pit. You got to fall in a chute, basically, because it says nothing about any stairs or any place down to this second level. You fall in the pit. That's it. It's like, and if you don't go down to that second level, I don't think you can find the third level.
No.
I don't think so. It's like, okay, I guess they're going to just go around the first level and come back up. Okay, fine. I would put, you know, some kind of passage or stairs or something in there, but that's a minor quibble. I also got kind of a problem with the ending, which Vince alluded to, which we will get to later. But all in all, I loved it. I thought it was a good read. It's going to be a good play.
Yeah, it's definitely a good module to play out. I liked it a lot because some of the twists and turns. And I especially liked the whole sisters thing in the middle of the forest.
Yeah, that was fun.
Yeah.
When they meet up with them and they're like, oh, we can give you this. Kind of like type deal thing.
And it's like, we're mercenary. We're not afraid to admit it.
No. And it's like a whole...
No, it's, a couple, it's a couple of little old ladies. Let's just take their stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, it's an illusion the whole time, so.
Yeah.
Well, their house is, so. Yeah.
The only problem I had about this module was the ending.
Yes.
With the dragon. The whole dragon at the end on the horde, and he keeps them there because he wants to chat. And then, in like.
Well, you know.
Wait, and then in two.
Then he gets bored.
Yeah, and then 2D12 rounds, he just says, I get bored. It says the dragon gets bored and tells them indirectly to get out. And if the players don't get out, he starts getting more direct until he starts attacking. But after that whole scenario is out, this is where the problem I have is. After that's all done, it says, on the way back, when the party subdued the dragon, wait, what, huh?
Well, did you notice how many hit points that dragon had?
No, I didn't really look exactly at the hit points.
It's low. I mean, I saw that. I mean, yeah, he's got his breath weapon, he's got, you know, some spells and stuff, but it's like, that's all?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but I don't know what party is going to think about subduing a dragon and having it follow back.
Yeah, then they're talking about, well, how do you get him across the lake and do this and doing that? It is like...
Well... What I thought was, like, first of all, I like the role-playing aspect of it, you know, talking to a dragon, all that kind of stuff. But,
yeah,
it doesn't come out and say you should subdue the dragon. It just says, if you can subdue... They give you, like, broad hints.
And that's, it's like, DM knowledge.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know, how would you convey that to the players unless they were, like, you know, they looked at the stats and go, oh, he's only got 30 hit points. All right, well, fine, we'll wrestle him to the ground or something.
I mean, yeah, correct me if I'm wrong, but... You know, back in the day, when I had a first, second, or third level character, and I run into a dragon, my first thought wasn't, let's subdue him!
Yeah. Let's get out of here.
Let's run like little girls. That's more like it.
Well, yeah. I think the only thing what you could do, and I was thinking about this after talking with Glenn, was maybe the dragon, the players are attacking it, and it gets down low enough, the dragon submits and bows down to the players.
Yeah. I give.
Yeah,
that was kind of the rules in basic.
Yeah.
Well, they do have like a lot of morale checks in this module for like the goblins and hobgoblins. I can't see why he wouldn't have a morale check if that happened.
Well, yeah, that's part of the subdual rules from Moldvay.
Okay.
Yeah.
What cracked me up is, assuming you subdued it, how do you get him across, like, it shows a picture of the dragon swimming behind the boat. How do you get him across, like, oh, I don't know, maybe have him fly across?
I don't know.
Well,
those wings
theoretically, if you let him fly across, there's nothing to keep him from flying on to the wild beyond.
Yeah, that's... You know,
oh, then, no, I'll meet you on the other side.
And then you have the DM. And then at the very, very end, you have that whole DM. If I don't want the players to have something, I have this whole hidden secret of the sisters that show back up and take whatever the DM pleases, pretty much, including the dragon. Yeah.
It's like, well, then why give it to him in the first place? I mean, don't. Just have them kill the dragon or run away. You know, I hate doing that as a DM. Okay, you've got it. Well, now I'm taking it from you.
Exactly.
Nope, the module says that.
I know, but it's kind of creepy in my opinion.
Getting him across the lake, to me, it's like, have the dwarf hop on his back, have him fly across. He tries to fly anywhere else. The dwarf bangs him with his warhammer.
Yeah.
Mm.
No!
Wow.
Bad boy. No!
So, what do you guys think about... Dwarfs? What do you guys think about the hook for this adventure? Of how there's a hill.
Yeah, there's a hill.
Yeah, there's a big, scary hill.
Yeah.
That's the other part of it that, you know, compared to B2. You know, B2, granted, the Caves of Chaos, but they were plural.
Yeah.
Everything's on this hill.
Just, there's the hill up there, and you'll find what you need.
There's tons of stuff in the hill.
Mm-hmm. That was kind of like, and it has a rumors table, like Liz said, and that was, everything is true, except for like one thing or two things.
Yeah, there's a couple of false ones, but yeah, most of the rumors are actually true. I think there should have been more, and, you know, if I was going to run it, I'd have added,
definitely.
You know, two or four more false ones to throw in there.
Of course, since this is B5, if you've played B1 through B4... you might be as a player going, okay, half of these have got to be wrong.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. Well, no.
No, sir, you are incorrect.
Yeah. On the other hand, yeah, I suppose it could be a big fake-out if you're thinking that your players are expecting them all to be false and you're actually giving them good information, but they're not going to follow through on it because they think that you're trying to trick them.
Exactly.
Because they come from a guy named Guido.
So basically, this whole adventure relies on the fact that we have very good players that want to help the fort, pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What if you got those bastard players in your group that could care less?
Then you play something else.
Yeah.
Or you'd have to figure out a way to have that little town offer a gold reward of some kind in order to check out the place.
Yeah. Or just to get rid of the dragon.
Yeah. If anything, dragon armor. Ooh.
Ooh. Ooh.
Yeah. Even a shield. Just a shield with dragon scales on it. Yeah. Ooh.
Of course, again, that gets back to, you know, are your first to third level characters really going to want to go, hey, let's go save them from this dragon? Let's not.
Well, then again, is it one of the rumors? One of the rumors is about the dragon. Okay.
Yeah.
I was going to say, do they even know about the dragon? They know about the goblins.
Yeah, there's rumors, and I can't but think that if a dragon is flying back and forth in the area, it's going to be noticed by somebody.
Okay.
Nope,
okay.
That's not a dragon in the sky.
It's a clouds. Yeah. It just looks like a dragon.
It's a, what are the, it's a hot...
It's a sturge. Yes. Yeah, that's it.
Nobody saw the dragon.
What did you say at Roswell? It was a hot water balloon or a hot weather balloon or something like
that? Weather balloon.
Yeah, it was just...
I saw the dragon, he backstabs him. Anybody else see the dragon?
Nope. No dragon. No dragon to be seen here.
In D&D, the men in black are assassins.
That's right.
Men in black, yeah. Use the zappy thing on you.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. The graveyard was kind of interesting. That's another graveyard on the hill, you know?
Yeah, that's a nice little diversion.
I like that this whole thing has to be done over a set period of time. I mean, it's not like you could sit down one night and do this whole module.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Some of them you can
actually
do.
Like what I would probably do with this module is I would break it up and use various sections for smaller adventures.
Really?
Yeah, I think I would, rather than having it all one huge cram together.
Yeah, kind of like what I told you about, like the mega dungeons we were talking about. Just kind of break them up and use pieces.
Yeah.
Mega dungeons. Wow.
Hey, some people like them.
Yeah,
and that's great.
I was just saying, wow, because I saw a book on eBay. Not eBay, it was on Amazon that said Mega Dungeon Pack Number 3, and it was like 1,000 pages worth of Mega Dungeons. I was like, why would anyone want to play that? 1,000 pages worth of dungeons that you can just keep going.
Remember that? What was it during Third Edition? They came out with the world's largest dungeon. It was like $100 in this telephone book sized book.
Yeah.
It's like Necromancer Games' Rappanathuk. It had like 12, 14 levels.
Oh, yeah.
Something like. Some people like them, and they're certainly old school.
I mean, Undermountain was a big seller.
Mm-hmm.
It's like playing Gauntlet, the video game. Remember that game?
Oh, I remember that.
Just dungeon level after dungeon level after dungeon level.
Yeah.
Kill the monster machine, yeah.
It gets... unless you've got like a backstory, like, dare I say it, before, which, by the way, I liked. Some people seem to have gotten the impression that I didn't like it. I just found the shenanigans about Robert E. Howard a bit of a gotcha. But anyway, you know, you've got the background to that potential mega dungeon. You know, you've got the Lost City, you've got the various factions, you've got a point to it all.
Well, that's a good question. We'll ask when Doug comes on the show. We'll ask him his whole thought process behind this module.
Speaking of tributes, I don't think anybody could ignore the fact that they're heavily tributing the cover of the Player's Handbook in First Edition on there.
Mm. Thank you. I'd forgotten about that. Yeah, the various discussions of the horned idol.
Yeah, and it shows, and various versions show up in different parts of the dungeon, with or without the jeweled eyes.
Yeah. Looks like someone has taken the eyes.
All they did was leave out the lizard men. That was
Yeah, there's no lizard men corpses laying around. But yeah. Yeah, thanks. I'd forgotten about that. Yeah.
Yeah, and there's like at least two of them that still had the eyes in them. Mm-hmm. One had a real nasty trap to take the eyes out.
So yeah, that was a nice little homage. Yeah.
So it's got some little Easter eggs in there for you.
Yeah. Well,
if you're smart enough to catch them, and I am.
And I liked how the goblins were running there.
Yeah, they were kind of cool.
Really?
Though I was a little disappointed about how the hobgoblins interacted with the goblins. It seemed more, well, this isn't tough enough. Let's just stick a few hobgoblins in there with the goblins to make it tougher. And it's like, well, I thought hobgoblins loved to bully goblins and make them do the skunk work.
That's what I always was.
So, yeah, why would the hobgoblins be here? Maybe one, just to make sure the goblins are doing what they're told, but...
Right. Well, what I'm wondering is, do you think that they had the captured thief in there and the indentured dwarven smith, do you think those were just put in there in case, like, the party loses somebody?
Yes.
Okay,
like the and the war dogs, which were really a stretch to me, but you know, yeah, I think it was there specifically to give players some bennies.
If you lose a fighter or a dwarf here, take this guy.
Be the thief.
Free.
Quite a lot of loot in there too.
Yeah,
heck of some a lot good of stuff loot. In there.
Well, they did give it a good justification of the fact that they were, you know, ramping up to attack the fort.
Right.
And the way the goblins are, it's no wonder the Goblin King can't get it organized enough to attack the fort.
True.
He's surrounded by idiots.
Yeah. All right. So let's...
Play him as a goblin Dr. Evil.
let's do our dragons now. It's usually we start with Liz.
Well, I'm going to be pretty kind to this one. I'm going to give it 4 dragons. Like I said, I enjoyed the different levels of monsters that were available, though I do agree the dragon should have had more hit points, and I probably would give it more. But you've got the rumor table, there's new monsters in the back, some of which I think are pretty keen, like the piranha bird.
Yeah.
Steam weevils!
Oh, God.
Yeah. I just love saying that. Steam weevils.
Steam weevils are a definite Denny. That's true.
Yeah.
But I especially like those piranha birds. Those just seem like they would be absolutely horrid to have dive bomb you. And they also have a Thule in the adventure as well.
And giant centipedes.
And giant centipedes, my personal favorite.
And kobolds.
Yes. So this it's module has everything.
Yes.
Except Doctor Who.
Except Doctor Mike. Who. But we could put that in.
What, have the doctor just show up and say hi?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Why not?
All right.
And the party would kill him and check his spleen for emeralds.
He might actually have some.
I'd like to see the next episode where he finds a couple of kobolds actually stowed away on the TARDIS.
So Liz is rating it a 4. Over to Mike.
Yes.
Who's torn. Who's very torn.
I can hear Beto screaming even now.
Yes. He's already.
But I'm going to
message.
Give it a 3, even though I gave 2.5 to B4. I'm going to give it a 3.
Really?
And yeah. Yeah.
All right.
Simply because, not in totally in and of itself, but because I see it as a great resource to basically break up and use here and there.
Yeah, yeah, okay. Sounds fair enough. And the G-Man.
You want to hear Beto howl? 5.
Wow. Glenn giving us the highest rating ever on the Saber
Day Podcast. It's a rock, man. I don't care about all this. there is nothing in here that any DM can't go, okay, he gets more hit points, I'll change this, boom, let's go have fun. I could justify going down the damn mountain.
All right, so Glenn, up on his
podium. He's just trying to goad Beto, I think.
Yeah, Beto, probably. We love you. well, he's still mad because we rated Rainbow Lodge higher than Lost City.
Right. Hey,
I was not part of that lodge rating, yeah. So I do not want to be lumped in with any of that.
I'm sorry, that was just bad. Anyway, it was a...
Well, we can hold you as the swing vote, so...
So I'm going to rate this one 4.5 out of 5. I really enjoyed it. I liked it a lot. The only problem I had was that dragon part at the end. I mean, subduing the dragon and having it follow
easily
you.
Easily fixable. Besides, most players aren't even going to even think about subduing something like that.
I know, but just the thought that it brought it up, I'm just going, what, well, huh? Flipping the page, subduing, what? I never even thought about that.
But it is very typical of old school modules, you know, the dragon at the bottom.
Well, why don't we take the dragon and put him in the Rainbow Lodge?
And he eats everyone?
Yes! No. He eats the horses they were supposed to fight.
Yeah. I shouldn't say anything. I haven't read it, so I don't know.
What, the Rainbow Lodge?
Yeah.
Don't worry about it. So, Glenn gives it a 5. I give it a 4.5. Liz giving it 4. And Mike throwing a big 3 curveball at it.
Boy, I'm the grump.
So that gives us a what? 4 point something. I don't know. Glenn, usually you do the ratings 8, in the forum, so.
13, yeah, but I'll do the math.
16.5.
Divided by 4.
4.1 something.
I'll call it 4.25.
Yeah, that works. All right, so check it out. Pick up on B5 Horror on the Hill by Doug Niles. Good module. I'm sure you can get it pretty cheap on Amazon or... Yeah. Drive through RPG. No, they don't have it on drive through anymore. That's right. Didn't Wizard pull all the stuff out?
I think they did.
Yeah, yeah. All old TSR stuff.
If you need it, contact me.
Yeah, I bought a copy of B5 from Noble Knight Games, and somehow I ended up with 2 covers, but only one book. Ooh. Yeah, it's weird.
Extra map.
Yeah.
So anybody needs an extra cover.
There you go. Or Noble Knight Games, or this Troll Lord still? No, Troll. What was the other? What was one of the ones?
Toad and Troll.
Toad.
Yeah, that's it.
Toad.
Yeah, don't they still sell it?
I have no idea. I've never ordered from them.
Oh, okay.
Normally, when I've looked at their stuff, I go over to Noble Knight and I find it cheaper. So, you know.
Really?
Yeah.
At least the stuff I've been interested in. Yeah.
I thought there was a high price spread. So.
It depends on the product you're looking at. One could be cheaper than the other, so.
Yeah. And to be fair, Noble Knight sometimes gets really weird on its pricing. Some things are really cheap, and others you're like, what?
Yeah.
Yeah. I'd rather just go
Amazon. I got 2 of those at a garage sale. What are you asking that for?
I go to Amazon mostly for my stuff.
Oh, yeah.
And if I really want it, I go on eBay, which Glenn and I was spending
a lot of time the other day.
We spent like an hour on it.
I just say no to eBay.
He just got a new copy of Cook, didn't you?
Yeah, I got the entire Expert Cook Amarsh set in box still with everything, including the original dice, too, for like $19.
Yeah. Pretty good.
Yeah.
I got the mini Expert set.
$17. Remember, Glenn, I made him an offer?
Yeah, that's right. You made an offer.
Yeah, and the guy took the $17 offer. That's right.
I mean, like within 10 minutes. He said, yeah, okay, fine. What's your
address? I needed another copy of it because my Cook was just like, it's so destroyed that it's so sad. So sad. That's how much I used it.
Yeah.
All right, I think that's going to wrap things up this week. So we're going to leave by. No, I'm kidding. So we're going to head down the lonely highway with our backpacks and sad music. And
the trucker going by. Woo!
Glenn is old, in the truck
sad.
Again. And Glenn has no brakes on his truck and goes off the cliff and dies.
Okay. There we go. And hit those kobolds on the bottom.
There you go.
Hey.
Next week on the Save or Die podcast, we'll be doing the B Solo module. So stay tuned for that, because we be tortured through that one, because I just started reading that one again, and I went,
Is that Ghost of Lion Castle?
Yeah.
Yeah, and I'm probably going to go, whatever you guys say, I hate solo modules.
We can automatically see Glenn's rating this one of probably a 1.
Yeah, well, you won't let me go any lower, that's why.
Well, you can go down to 0.25, all right?
Oh, yeah, okay.
A dragon nostril.
A dragon claw.
One a pseudo dragon.
Oh.
A but dragon dropping.
Ooh. That was a little uncalled for, Glenn.
Yeah, well, that was the PG version, all right?
Just when I think I've hit the lowest, Glenn always shows me up.
Yeah, he's there to show you up.
Hey, yep. I'm the butt monkey of the show. What do you want?
On that note, butt monkeys
tragic,
all.
Tragic, awkward note.
Yeah, we're going to have to say goodbye, folks, and we'll see you next week on the Save or Die podcast.
Oh, yeah. Good night, everybody!
Goodbye.
Free arc.
If you have any comments, please email saveordiepodcast@gmail.com or visit saveordie at saveordie.info. Follow the cast on Facebook / Save or Die Podcast, or follow them on Twitter @TheEvilDM.